Okay, well, thanks everybody for coming. I've done several hundred presentations in the last couple of months, but they've all been the sort of staid, sanitised, corporate type of presentation, so this is a bit more relaxed. So what I'll be talking about is, well, first of all, I'll explain the title. I'll talk about how we found the thing, show you some of the deposit and the geology and so on, to the extent that we know at this point in time, and then wind up with a few other bits and pieces. And throw in a few of my opinions on things along the way. So, why is this called Who Dares Wins? Well, a number of people have said, how did we find this? And the simple answer is that we were stupid enough to believe that we could. So we went out and did it and found it. These are a few points that we've garnered along the way, if you like. Those of you who are in exploration, particularly the junior sector, know some of these things very well. Exploring as a junior explorer is about backing yourself and going against the odds, and the odds are pretty steep. Going out and doing greenfields exploration is really insane odds in general, but should you be fortunate enough to find something, then the reward is worth it. And that's what we've seen. On our website, we said we're not about messing around near old shows, we're about going out into new areas and making order of magnitude returns on investment. And we've managed to do that, fortunately. And for any of you in a small company having to do this with shareholders on your back and not much money in the bank, you know that it takes a lot of courage and grim determination, often with the emphasis on the grim. It can be pretty grim when you're out there plugging away and nobody is your friend. But really, you know, the job of an MD of a junior explorer is to keep the shareholders believing, and it's a bit like selling religion because you've got nothing tangible to show them or for analysts to measure. You've just got to go out there and sell an idea and keep people believing, which a number of our shareholders did for 2 years. And they eventually, having been underwater, made a 4,500% return on their investment. So, you know, we use a lot of science, but there's also a lot of art involved as well and a lot of instinct. And because of that, it's not suited to big companies when we have to justify what we do in spreadsheets to managers. That's why the big companies tend to do themselves out of this. It needs lateral thinkers, non-conformists, people who don't necessarily slot well into a corporate mould. And it needs freedom so that people aren't stifled. There's a lot of small companies around as well that choose to conserve their funds in the hope that something better will come along. But one lesson I've learned in all of this is all of our shareholders have said, without exception, they'd rather us go hard, spend the money, and if we fail, we fail. But they prefer that to us just stringing it out and stringing them out. And I guess this is just a little aside, really. What we found is small groups are much more efficient, much more effective at doing things than big groups because you're just focused on what you're doing, not managing people, and that's why the small companies are often the successful ones. The Nova discovery is in the Fraser Range, east of Norseman, about 100 k's east of Norseman, 30 k's north of the Air Highway, pretty well opposite where the Fraser Range Caravan Park is, if any of you have been out that way. It's we have a patch of ground out there that covers about 120 k's of strike and about 2,000 square kilometres that we got through doing a deal with Mark when we put the company together. It's we went in there looking for the thing we've actually found unusually. It was not just our idea, it was the idea of other people. Newmont were in there back in the 60s looking for base metals in conjunction with WMC and others. Inco and Falconbridge were there more latterly. They did a lot of broad brush airborne surveys south of where we are and I guess didn't follow through on the ground and then got taken out by Vale and Xstrata. And the GSWA did some regional laterite sampling and one of those samples lit up over what is now Nova, which is an important ingredient in this. And despite being only 30 k's off the highway, it's like walking into a new country. There's no tracks, you have to walk in. It's flat, it's not rugged, but it's heavily wooded, so you have to walk in, get off your bum, and you can go there and do the simple things and the cheap things without having to resort to fancy technology or drilling massively deep holes. I think it really shows that Australia is not a mature country. It's not overexplored. You can walk out and find things like this, and there are plenty more. So, our opportunity was really having the access to the ground through our relationship with Mark Creasy as a major shareholder of Sirius. And we were able to cherry pick his ground holdings. On that right-hand slide there, it's a magnetic image. You can see the various tenements of ours and the joint venture. But most of the gap in the middle of those is held privately by Mark. So he holds probably 80% of an entire belt. And that's a fantastic ingredient for us. We went looking for the same things that Inco and Falconbridge went looking for, which is intrusive associated circumcratonic nickel sulfide deposits of the type that occur in Canada. And this is just a slide of Canada showing the belt there, which is the circumsuperior belt, expressed as the Cape Smith nickel belt up at Raglan, runs through Manitoba and contains Thompson and Voisey's Bay off to one side of it on the Labrador coast there. Now, the key thing about these deposits is they are entirely different from the typical Australian Kamatiite-style deposit. These things are generally mafic-hosted. They occur in sills or intrusions as opposed to lava flows. They're Proterozoic, not Archean, and they're an order of magnitude bigger. So, you know, a typical WA Kamatiitic nickel deposit as a single chute may be 1 to 2 million tonnes at 3 to 5%. These deposits occur in clusters to form camps, and collectively you're talking about 10 to 100 million tonnes at 2 to 3% nickel. And the other key difference is they contain copper, often cobalt, and sometimes PGEs. So Thompson's mainly nickel with a bit of copper. Raglan is nickel as it shows there, plus copper, plus PGEs, and Voisey's Bay doesn't have PGEs, but it has a lot of cobalt as well. So they're all sort of different variations on a familiar theme. And that's what we have at Nova. I'm not suggesting it's the same scale as this, but it's certainly the same style. So just as a bit of a story, I guess this is where we were as a small exploration company 3 months ago. There were three of us, me and two junior geologists. We had a small office and a warehouse in Balcatta to keep the overheads low. And when we actually found this, we had less than $1 million left in the bank and counting. And probably the money we saved by not having a West Perth office allowed us to drill the holes that made this discovery. At that time, our share price was hovering between 5 and 6 cents. We were a penny dreadful. Our market cap was 7 million. I was banging on doors in Melbourne and Sydney and nobody was answering. We had insufficient funds to really be effective. And the drill program that was the discovery drill program was going to be the last bit of drilling we did for several months. So we were in the position, like many people, where we were facing the possibility of having to raise money at a massive discount, which would be highly dilutive. It would give us a little bit of money to not be that effective and alienate most of our shareholders who'd be horribly diluted. But they kept the faith. They were in there for 2.5 years, and they're all very happy now. We also had a lot of options that were ridiculously out of the money at 60 cents, which were probably worth more as wallpaper than options. So what happened to change things is we used the government magnetics. We didn't fly our own, we just used the off-the-shelf magnetics. We defined 5 targets in those magnetics because we couldn't afford to do broad brush exploration. We had to be very surgical in what we did. Our budget wouldn't allow us to do big airborne surveys, otherwise we'd go broke before we even got to first base. So we said, okay, we'll be very selective. We'll take a risk, we'll identify 5 or 6 targets, and we'll test one of those. The first one we've tested is a thing called the eye, which is this lenticular shape thing in the magnetics. And this is where Nova was found, and I'll show you the details of that later. But really we said, okay, that's a nice looking structure. We don't know what it is. There's no outcrop. No one knows anything about the geology out here. But it looks like it could be either an intrusion or a dome or a layered complex, all of which in a general sense are potentially prospective for nickel copper sulfides. So we went in and did the first stage of testing, and we hired two vacation students for the summer. Those two guys walked in 8 kilometres every day through the woods to the target, because there are no tracks, collected the soil samples, and it was the soil anomaly that was produced by that work that was the next tick in the box. Yeah, okay. What we did then, I'll come back to that, is over that area there we did moving loop EM geophysics, and our good friend Bill Amann from New Exco oversaw that. I don't know if Bill's here tonight or not. There. Good. Even better. And for probably a ridiculously small amount of money, probably $40,000, we defined three big booming EM anomalies that initially looked too big to be the sort of thing you'd be looking for when you're looking for nickel sulfides, because generally the big anomalies are the false anomalies. They're the formational conductors, and you're looking for the pimple on the side of those rather than the big ones. We didn't have any pimples. We had three big ones, and we chose to drill one of those first. It's simply conductor 1, 2 and 3. Conductor 1 was 100 metres down, conductor 2, 200 metres down, conductor 3, 300 metres down. And we drilled the southern end of the first anomaly simply because it was closest to surface and we could only afford 3 RC holes. So this is the discovery hole, and this is the sort of photo record as it happened. The lead up to this was one of those classic exploration stories, in that the money was coming out the bank account paying for the drillers. It had rained. The drillers were sitting on their bums on standby at $6,000 a day. We couldn't get into the site because the station had closed the tracks. So we waited for a week. We eventually got in, started drilling the hole. The rig broke down for a day. We got very frustrated. So on Friday, we recommenced drilling. Bill had modelled the conductor at 180 metres down this hole. At 7 p.m. when it got too dark to continue, we'd got to 181. And that photo there is of Malcolm, our geologist, looking at what he thinks is little bits of sulphide in the sieve there from the last metre. But we had to wait all of Friday night contemplating our future to resume drilling the next day. We drilled another 10 metres and we hit 4 metres at 4% nickel. And that was the discovery hole in late July. As a result of what's happened since then, we went straight from the first hole to a resource drill out because, as you'll see shortly, the deposit is a no-brainer. It's amenable to just pattern drilling and mining. We've now got 40 people on site and 10 in Perth. Our share price is about $230. Our market cap is over $500 million now. We've got regular hordes of merchant bankers coming up to Balcatta for the first time, offering us money. The money we do have, we're fully funded to releasing a maiden JORC indicated resource. We're not going to bother with an inferred. We'll go straight to indicated. We did an initial capital raising of $7 million, which was only a small raising. It was enough to get us drilling without diluting the shareholders too much. So it was a 6% dilution. It got us drilling. The results from that triggered 30-odd million options that were due to expire in December to get exercised. So the income from the exercise of those options has funded our exploration program. As a result, we've got $18 million in the bank at the moment. Our shareholders are all very happy now. They've made 4,500% return on their investment. And I've been able to get back together a lot of people from the Lion Ore days who are all plug and play, so they're immediately effective. And as we received the Mines and Money Discovery of the Year Award in about a month ago. So what Nova is hopefully the first chapter in a big, thick book. In the 3 months since we found it, we've drilled 90 diamond holes. We've got five rigs punching out half a kilometre of core a day. The deposit, as we've defined it, Nova itself, is about 500 metres along its long axis from southwest to northeast. It plunges from southwest down into the northeast. It's 300 or 400 metres wide, and in the middle it's 60 metres thick. And we've completed the first pass drilling on that. We've got a three-dimensional wireframe. We're doing the infill drilling, and everywhere we plug an infill hole into that wireframe, that intersection comes within half a metre of prediction. So it's amazingly continuous and predictable. We're also drilling at Conductor 5, which is that brown square to the northeast, which is probably just a little separate horizon off to the side. There is an anomaly to the north of Nova, but it's obscure and we can't quantify it very well. There could be a conductor down there as well. It's not something we can constrain and put as a shape on a piece of paper like that, but we'll be putting a wild cat hole down into that this week. And that Conductor 5 is at the southern end of an IP anomaly that stretches for 2 kilometres up to the next conductor. And where we've drilled it so far, we've got up to 35 metres of disseminated and stringer sulphides. So that IP anomaly has been verified as being sourced by sulphides, and we could have a large tonnage of lower grade mineralisation stretching for 2 kilometres from here to the next EM conductor. This is slightly out of date now, but it gives you a sort of rough idea of what the thing looks like in three dimensions. So the squares on that diagram are 100 metres by 100 metres. The top left is the near surface up plunge tip of the deposit. It comes to within about 50 metres of surface and is unoxidised. It plunges off to the northeast and then it flattens out at about 300 metres and forms a big pool of massive sulphide. Now the tonnes per vertical metre here are just off the scale, and it's a nice, neat, compact blob with a lot of nickel and copper metal in it. I'll just run you through some sections. From south to north, this is the section we made the discovery on. Don't know what that thing's doing. So the mineralisation there from top to bottom is about 200 metres. And what we've got on each of these slides down at the bottom right-hand side, is a section through Lunnon, which is one of the better Cambalda deposits at the same scale to give you a sense of what this looks like in terms of both size and simplicity. The discovery hole that you can see two-thirds of the way down there was the 4 metres at 4% nickel and 1.4 copper. We've got up to 13 at 4 nickel and 1.8 copper as well on that section, and we were very happy about that. But in hindsight, this is just the tail of the tiger. The next section, 50 metres north, which is 75 metres down plunge, is currently being drilled as an infill section because we originally started on 100 metre space sections, which is 150 metre down plunge step outs, which is an awful long way for a nickel sulphide deposit. But here we're still on the tail of the tiger here, but we're getting broad zones of lower grade mineralisation. Then we step another 50 metres north or 75 metres down plunge. And now the deposit is starting to grow. From top to bottom there, it's 350 metres. And the middle bit in the thicker bit of that lens is 35 metres thick. So it's like a 12-storey building thickness in the middle there. At 3.5 nickel and 1.5 copper. Now this is into the heart of the deposit now. Here it's still 350 metres from left to right, but it's 60 metres thick or more at 3.5% nickel and 1 and a bit percent copper. Even that utmost tip that's terminating up there, it looks tiny, but we've got 3.5 metres at 5.7 nickel and 0.5% copper, which is eminently mineable. So it's the thickness of this thing that really makes it what it is. Moving north again, 50 metres further north, 75 metres further down plunge. It continues, more of the same. This is another infill line that we're doing, and the first hole we had on that was 35 metres true width at just under 4% nickel and 1.7 copper. And I think finally this is the northernmost section on the Nova deposit itself, and it's starting to look a bit insignificant again, but again, true width, 28 metres at 4.5% nickel and 1.7 copper. And we're just starting to see signs of the next thing creep in at conductor 5 up to the upper right there. 100 metres further north, and we're starting to latch on to this zone of disseminated and stringer sulfides that could be the start of this 2 kilometre long corridor. This is just one section of several, but there's 20 to 30 metres of sulfides there. And that picture on the left is showing some of the sulfides. So there are significant breccia sulfides there, as well as just disseminated sulfides. Now, just going back a bit, if I can find it. That hole on the right-hand side, which is hole 13, probably 12 months ago, we did a dozen RC holes, just reconnaissance RC holes, to try and understand the geology before we even had conductors or knew that this thing was here. And one of those was a government co-funded drill hole that we drilled. Unfortunately, we didn't get all the way. We only got down to about 300 metres, but with hindsight, if we'd have kept going, we could have hit this thing 12 months ago just by pure fluke. And that, I'm just going to go through some of the geology now. We don't know a lot about the geology because it's lower granulite facies. The rocks are pretty mind-bending. They're totally different to the typical rocks you see associated with Camartiotic deposits, and rocks in the goldfields in generally. Basically, it's a mixture of different gneisses, two real gneisses. What we think they represent is a sediment sill complex, and that the nickel sulfides are at the base of these sills that have been deformed, metamorphosed, and sort of cooked up beyond all recognition. But what you see in the hanging wall side, you see essentially what we call a 2-pyroxene gneiss, which is a hypersthene augite, hornblende, plage rock, and there's a bit of trace sulfide in that. This, we're interpreting this as a very strongly metamorphosed metagabbro or gabbro-norite. And this is part of the mafic sill that hosts the mineralisation. As you go down through the sequence, in a classic sense, you get more and more sulfide. So you get into neck textured and then matrix sulfides. And interestingly, you also get reverse neck texture and leopard texture, which is, we've seen up at Raglan in Canada quite often. Jeff Foster, one of the other directors of Sirius, and myself, we also have a private exploration company in Canada exploring along strike from Extrata at Raglan, and we're drilling similar stuff there. Now, then you get into the massive sulfides and you get trays and trays of it. And it's pretty spectacular stuff. It's very coarse-grained and very simple mineralogy. In places, it's very copper-rich, as you'd expect in one of these styles of deposits. You can see the chalcopyrite there. And perversely, the geos on site have been known to get annoyed by there being so much chalcopyrite because it displaces the nickel sulfides. And just in a bit of detail, because this This was emplaced as a magmatic deposit, then it cooled and crystallised, and then it was metamorphosed to lower granulite facies. It's been cooked up again, and what's happened as a result of that is the grain size has increased, so you get a very coarse grain size. All of the nickel that may have been in the pyrrhotite and metallurgically unrecoverable has been cooked out into pentlandite around the rims of the pyrrhotite grains, and the chalcopyrite is quite a separate phase as well. So rather than having a very fine-grained intergrowth of different sulfides with limited recovery, or indeed nickel in pyrrhotite, which you can't recover, or indeed nickel in silicates, which you can't recover, it's all a metallurgist's dream. You've got three simple minerals, well-known, easy to liberate, should grind, crush very quickly. The nickel and copper yield from this should be very good. Our metallurgical consultant is of the opinion that we should be able to form a separate nickel and copper concentrate from this rather than a mixed concentrate, which means it'll be worth a lot more money without much more capital expenditure. Also, there's zero arsenic. Arsenic doesn't even register on the scale in the laboratory, so it makes a very nice clean concentrate, which should help things as well. The cobalt that we get goes with the nickel, and the silver goes with the copper. So hopefully we'll be able to produce a nickel cobalt concentrate and a copper silver concentrate sold to different off-takers. And then you get into the footwall, and you get a very distinct change of geology. You get basically a garnet quartz gneiss, which is we interpret to be a cooked up metasediment. It is variably deformed, mainly around the edges. We generally see in the middle it seems to be intact with a gradation from massive to matrix to net to disseminated, still in situ, whereas around the edges there's a bit more mobilisation. And we see two types, really. We see stringer sulfides like this, which is a ductile gneissic banding, and we also see more of a brittle breccia sulfide as well. So that particular one is just showing some of the nickel stringers within the two pyroxene gneiss. And in other places we get wackier rocks like this one, which is mostly garnet with quartz and chalcopyrite, and occasionally nice, almost gem-quality olivine and pyroxene. You get a lot of minerals that shouldn't actually coexist together all in the same spot. So that's Nova in brief. What is above and beyond Nova? This is a series of stack profiles of induced polarisation chargeability sections over that I geological structure. There's no line in the middle because there were drill rigs on that and we couldn't put a line down there, but you'll see that yellow plate in the middle is the Nova EM conductor, and you can see a nice IP chargeability anomaly above the north end of that, and that's where we're currently drilling disseminated sulfides and stringer sulfides around conductor 5. The next line to the north has got an even stronger chargeability anomaly, which is totally unexplored at this point in time. And then the next line to the north, you can see another yellow rectangle, which is conductor 3, with a chargeability IP anomaly closely associated with that. So all things being equal, hopefully, what that's telling us is we've got another massive sulfide position there with some associated disseminated sulfides sitting above and around it. And then over on the right-hand side, that green parallelogram, this thing here, this is conductor 2, which is another real strong EM anomaly. Unfortunately, with not having an IP line over the top of it, we can't see if there's an associated chargeability anomaly, but 400 metres to the north, there's a hint of one, and this will be the next thing we drill. So we've got Nova as a deposit. We're hoping that conductor 2 will be a bolt-on and that conductor 3 will be a bolt-on, and that between Nova and conductor 3, there could be up to 2 kilometres strike length of disseminated sulfides. And what we've seen so far is very consistent with these types of systems in that you get a combination of pods of massive big zones have disseminated. And that's what you see at Tamarack in the US, which is owned by Rio, Kabanga in Tanzania, owned by Xstrata and Barrick, and at a place called Sakati in Finland, which is being drilled by Anglo-American at the moment. So it's very typical of these giant systems. This is just a summary slide of the single tenement that Nova is within, which is about 50 square k's. It's just one of many tenements we have. The eye is in the middle of it. Nova is on the western rim in here. Conductor 5 is in here. That IP anomaly stretches all the way around the northwestern rim up to conductor 3, which is in the nose of this structure here. And conductor 2 sits on the eastern rim of it. So what we're seeing is, we don't know until we've drilled it, that'll determine whether these are massive sulfides or not. But what we're seeing is a bunch of conductors, one of which we know to be massive sulfides, that are arrayed around this structure in a place you would expect them to be if they were magmatic nickel sulfides. The dashed white line is the extent of our exploration. We haven't set foot outside of there, other than this week we've started an EM survey down through here as well. We'll wait and see what that yields. And this is just really a summary. It's definitely a major discovery. We don't have a JORC resource yet, although we keep an internal informal resource going should we need to produce one in a hurry. We're very confident that this is a no-brainer. This is a mine. Geologically, it looks very much like its Canadian cousins, and the fact that we've got other conductors that we need to drill around there that all look good gives us a lot of hope that this won't be the only one here. We've got a fairly commanding position in this belt, and we're well funded to actually capitalise on that. Our biggest worry early on was that some of the other usual suspects in WA, Panoramic, Mincor, Western Areas, etc., may take a fancy to this and have a crack at us, but fortunately our share price and market cap was such that it got us into a fairly protected position. If this keeps growing, I guess it'll come under the crosshairs of the majors, but we're also very lucky in that having Mark Creasy there as a supportive cornerstone investor protects us somewhat. Our role right now is to drill this thing as fast as we can, try and get it into development as fast as we can, and avoid being taken out by some bargain hunter. And I guess through this we've learnt a few lessons. I mean, a lot of these are sort of downright sort of obvious common sense. But really we had a simple plan. We didn't try and get too fancy. We stuck to it. We made sure we raised the money to execute it. Back in December 2010, we raised $10 million, and as part of an incentive for the participants of that capital raising, we gave them one 60-cent option for every two shares they bought. But we gave those options a two-year timeline so that they would mature essentially now, which was synchronised with our exploration program, so that should we be successful, there'd be a reason and an incentive and an imperative for them to exercise those options, which is exactly what's happened. So we've been getting between $1 and $5 million a week through the door to fund what we're doing. As I said, we put the money in the ground, not in a fancy office, which is the way to go. We've just been old-fashioned. We've done greenfields exploration. We've done it in boring old Australia rather than Indonesia or Africa or wherever, because having put all this effort into it, the last thing we want to do is have the rug pulled from underneath us when it becomes something that's worth anything. We've stuck to the things we know well, which is gold and nickel primarily. Having a small team is definitely the way to go. You end up focusing on the important stuff rather than the peripheral stuff. But we wouldn't have done it without our shareholders, so a lot of my time is spent keeping them believing, which is easier now than it was 6 months ago. We've also you may have seen a lot of stock exchange announcements from us, but that's quite deliberate in that we want to be totally transparent and ensure that everybody is fully informed, because a lot of investors are totally sick of the spin and the bullshit that often gets out there. And I had a meeting with about 10 fund managers in Sydney, and they said, "Oh, you're not another Perth snake oil salesman." And they said, "We don't mind if things go wrong, if it's bad news. You tell us the truth, and we'll stick with you." So that's worth remembering. In our stock exchange announcements, we never say Sirius is pleased to announce, because we just say Sirius announces, because we may not always be pleased to announce. And we just focus on what we do, which is exploration, not a lot of the other political stuff. Let everybody else get on with that. And I guess we employ people who really care. One of the casualties of the mining boom is that it's attracted a lot of people into the industry who are in it for the money rather than the love, and it makes a difference. But we do reward them. We give our guys options. We've got guys with 2 years' experience out of uni who are paper millionaires right now. And the key thing, again, with shareholders is what they want to see is us spending their money, not sitting down drinking lattes. So they would prefer us to go out there, spend it and fail trying, rather than not to have tried. And I think that's about it. Yeah, won't let me go anymore.